long years ago, when I was in sin, I had no hope, no peace within. Down on my knees in agony, I prayed to Jesus and he gladly set me in. I never shall forget the day when all the burdens of my soul were rolled away. While it makes me happy, glad and free, I'm gonna shout it, for it's everything to me. Oh, sinner, come to Jesus now, and at his feet just humbly bow. Confess to him your every sin. He'll save and cleanse you, give you peace and joy within. I never shall forget the day when all the burdens of my soul rolled away. While it makes me happy, glad and free, I'm gonna shout it, for it's everything to me. Oh, sinner, come to Jesus now, and at his feet just humbly bow. I never shall forget the day when all the burdens of my soul were rolled away. While it makes me happy, glad and free, I'm gonna shout it, for it's everything to me. Amen. You may be seated. We are so thankful to the Lord to bring us back into the hours of fellowship. We are grateful to the Lord for giving us good health. It's so good to have a good, healthy body, my brothers and sisters. You know, it's so difficult to live in a sick body. And we thank God, you know, that he can make us fit and able today to come once again into his house of fellowship. We thank God for the additional additional baby to our body. We give God all the glory, honor, and praise. I just know the joy and the Jodesh and Joan is feeling. And may the child grow up in the ways of the Lord. Amen. Amen. You think Joan will have a song this morning? You can come and stand here if you want to.
Okay, John's going to give a testimony.
I don't want to miss the opportunity of just thanking the Lord for all that he has done for both Jody and I and baby. I just want to thank God for carrying us through and taking us on this journey, and especially to our church as well, for all the prayer, the support, and just having people to stand by you when you need that prayer to take you through. And I know Jody shared a bit of our baby's birth, but it was just God's hand that was with us, and we saw the Lord in everything. So I just want to thank the Lord, just give him all the praise, the glory and honor. There's nothing that's too hard for him, and we just need to trust in him and just walk with him every step of the way.
You don't know the song. Amen. I greet you all in the name of Jesus. It's a privilege to be here. want to go into too much detail, but I feel I won't do justice if I don't talk about the testimony of our baby. In 2022, Joan fell very ill towards the end of the year. Very bad. She was in hospital in and out. Nights, I had to stay over. It was a very bad situation. I honestly didn't know if she was going to live. That's how bad it was. End of 2022, for some reason, when she was getting better, something told me when I bought my diary for the new year, write 28 December as the date, which is so ridiculous if you ask anyone to do that. But anyway, I wrote the date and I wrote a boy's name and a girl's name there. Anyway, fast forward, when we realized we're having a baby, I found out it's going to be in 2024. So I didn't think about that date. But then when we saw our doctor towards the end of the year, he told us, no, you have to stay in and we're going to monitor you. And then 2 days from then, he told us, no, it's going to happen. It's going to be on the 29th. And I told everyone, look how good God is. He told me about this date and he's only 1 day off. Not realizing, on the 28th in the night, we had to go into an emergency C-section because she went into distress. And God kept his promise. He kept his word. You know, there were actually times that we thought we were going to lose her. But God brought us all through, and for that, I have to give him thanks. You know, in situations like that, you can have how much money you want in the world, biggest of houses, best of cars, best of friends. No one's going to help you. There's only one person you can turn to. Can join me? Yeah. I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or land. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hand than to be the king of a vast domain and be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. I'd rather have Jesus than worldly applause. I'd rather be faithful to his dear cause. I'd rather have Jesus than worldwide fame. Yes, I'd rather be true to his holy name than to be the king of a vast domain and beheld in sin's dread stream, I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. Amen.
Amen. We thank God for that song and testimony. I wonder if my brother Dion can sing a song. I'd like him to sing You'll Always Be a Child in My Eyes, but if you got another song, you can always sing what's on your mind.
Amen. I greet you in the name of Jesus. Thank God for this opportunity. You can be found in His presence. I thank Him for His grace and His mercy. I thank Him for the breath of life this morning and for all things. Every little blessing, I just give God all the praise and glory.
I was there when you drew the breath of life, and I could hear your voice the first time that you cried. And though you couldn't see me, I was very near. And there's something now that I want you to hear. You will always be a child in my eyes. When you need some love, my arms are open wide. And even when child in my eyes, I was there the first time that you prayed, and I heard all the promises you made. And when you fell before, Father, I have sinned, I picked you up and held you close again. You will always be a child in my eyes. When you need some love, my arms are open wide. I hope you realize you will always be a child in my eyes. You will always be a child in my eyes. And when you need some love, my arms are open wide. When I hope you realize you will always be a child in my eyes. You will always be a child.
Testimony. Shall we stand to our feet? There is always enough of God's mercy. Always enough of His love.
Greet you all in the lovely name of Jesus Christ. Let's bow for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful that we can gather together in your presence, Lord. You are the God that has watched over the lives of your people, my God. I pray for every child that is here, my God, as well as abroad, my Father. May your presence be with them, my God. Lord, you see them many on the beds of affliction, my God. I pray, dear Lord, that you will bless them and strengthen them as well, my God. We thank you also, Lord, for the sweet bundle of joy, my God, that you've given our brother and sister, my God. We pray, dear Lord, and we thank you, dear God, that you're an on-time God, my Father. Lord, we pray for your precious word. We pray that you'll break your word to us this morning, my God. Lord, we depend upon thee, my God, to guide us, to lead us, and help us along this way. We ask these mercies in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Amen. You can be seated this morning, my brothers and sisters. We thank the Lord this morning for His grace and His mercy in our lives. This morning the lights went off at 7:45 and I was getting ready. I typed the SMS out. You know, we can't have service because it was a large blackout. And I was just rereading it and was getting ready to just send it out. And we would have missed what is here today. But we thank God, brothers. And as soon as I did that, just before I could do that, the lights came on. I thank God, brothers and sisters, that He knows exactly. And He knows our needs this morning. We have a message this morning. We entitled it, Turning Israel's Mountains into a Way. Turning Israel's Mountains into a Way. We realize, my brothers and sisters, this has been a very nervous, anxious week for the nation of Israel. In many ways, my brothers and sisters, and yesterday she, I would say, remembered the Jews that went through the Holocausts 79 odd years ago. It was the 70th memorial. And the world has thought, my brothers and sisters, they can place this nation in a trap. But we see, brothers and sisters, man can only go so far. He cannot go further than what God entails in his word. Now, my brothers and sisters, we have the scriptures, Zechariah 4:7 there, and Isaiah 49:11. We're going to deal with this scripture more than this. But brothers and sisters, we know at the first coming of Christ that when the children of Israel came out of Babylon, my brothers and sisters, they had come back to Israel. And my brothers and sisters, Jerusalem was lying in ruins. My brothers and sisters, there were boulders everywhere. Brothers and sisters, it was not a good sight to think that they will ever be able to reconstruct Jerusalem back, I would say, to the glory days. But we know in Zechariah chapter 4, verses 7, brothers and sisters, the Spirit of the Lord begins to speak and says, it's not by might nor by power, but by my Spirit the mountain will be made a plain. That means every obstruction was going to be taken away out of the pathway for the building of that temple. Now, my brothers and sisters, almost 2,000 some odd years has passed by, and we are getting ready for the second coming of Christ. And we know that there is to be another temple built, but there are so many obstacles in the way. We see, brothers and sisters, on October 7th, what had taken place, we see how the international world has wanted to put blockades against the nation of Israel. But if we close circuit what is happening, you will see, brothers, every time they do something, God's miraculous hand in the background is just shutting it down. Brothers and sisters, you know this war that is in some 100 days plus, and the world has felt that, you know, we will get Israel in a corner and we will get her to have a ceasefire, as much as they took Israel to the ICJ, but they never got that. They got a few things, but it never materialized to what they wanted. And my brothers and sisters, then we see what has happened in the Red Sea. Up till today, brothers, that's going on, that's taking the problem away from Israel. And also, brothers and sisters, UNRWA, brothers and sisters of the United Nations, now there's almost 8 major nations that have pulled the funding out of the United Nations refugee camp, I would say. Now, my brothers and sisters, that lets me know God is putting brakes on all sides. That is why, as we look at this in Zechariah chapter 4, God knew how to plane the way. And when we see in Isaiah chapter 49, it says, I will make all my mountains a way, and my highways shall be exalted. Now, we will talk further about the scripture later in the message, but just to generalize it, it says, I will make all my mountains a way. Other translations say, every mountain shall be made into a way. In other words, every barricade, every obstruction, every opposition is going to be cleared by God, and a way is going to be made for the nation of Israel. Remember, the same thing took place when the children of Israel came out of Egypt. Brothers and sisters, the right way to have gone was the caravan route, 11 days journey to the promised land. But God took them another route, brothers and sisters, and brought them to the Red Sea, where there was obstruction, where there was obstacles. The reason being, God was going to perform miraculous things so that his name shall be glorified. I realize for the nation of Israel, for the hostages, for the people, as well as all of us, to look at what is going on is painful. But brothers and sisters, God sees the bigger picture. Now, this scripture was not written yesterday. This scripture was written almost 2,700 years ago when it says, I will make all my mountains, that's the obstructions, that's the oppositions, a way. He will clear it to produce a way, and then God will make the highway so that that's a miraculous highway for his name to be glorified. So we see, brothers and sisters, that almost, I would say 70, more than that it is, but they had a memorial of the 79, I would say, day of Holocaust yesterday. Normally the 27th, brothers and sisters, is the day of January that they all get together to remember this. Now, my brothers and sisters, you and I know we've talked about this many times. Brothers and sisters, the world looks at the Holocaust only from a traditional view. In other words, yes, the first few, I would say, Remembrance Day, they some of them shed tears, some of them were crying, but as time went on, they just were forced to, I would say, have a day of memorial with the Jewish people. But this time around, my brothers and sisters, this was the first Holocaust, I would say, that happened in the gas chambers of Hitler. But on the 7th of October, the Jewish nation now looks at it as the second Holocaust. And my brothers and sisters, the world at large, they so quickly forgot, because from October 7th, two brothers and sisters, the last few weeks, you would have seen other nations, even our own country, brothers and sisters, they, if they really felt what took place in the Holocaust, they should have been a little slower in going the way they went. But nonetheless, it lets us know, brothers and sisters, that people only, they have a short memory. Therefore, God has to remind this world, and he gets it to a certain point, and then he's going to clear the way. So, brothers and sisters, we see that even on the newscast, brothers and sisters, there was Sky News, there was this interviewer interviewing Denon. And my brothers, as the interview went forth, she had said something, brothers and sisters, to say, well, you know what is going on in Gaza is like the same as what has went on in the painful times of the Holocaust. Brothers and sisters, if I ever saw a man, just, I would say, he couldn't take that statement. He said, you might as well just take the statement back, or apologize, because that's not the same. He said, we did not bring about this situation in Gaza. It was brought upon the people of the PLO. And so, brothers and sisters, we also recognize and remember what took place, brothers and sisters, almost 7 decades ago. And because of that, they had said, brothers and sisters, for 79 years, I would say, never again will we allow this to happen. And I would say Israel did everything in its power. She got the best army. Brothers and sisters, she has got some of the best equipments in the world to let this never happen again. But on the 7th of October, we know a second Holocaust took place. Now, my brothers and sisters, we have to realize this is all playing in the agenda of God, because the world was forgetting about the first Holocaust. Even the government of Israel was forgetting about it. Even the people said, you know what, we don't want to remember about this. It really takes the joy away. And so, brothers and sisters, God, I would say, allowed this to go about so that he could awaken them up. Because, brothers and sisters, really speaking, the world doesn't really know what is to take place, I would say, not in the distant future. I don't have a date or a time, but watching the events, brothers and sisters, remember the ICJ
gave Israel 30 days to respond. And remember, they did a good thing by saying there's no ceasefire. What do you think the generals are thinking in their mind? Brothers and sisters, they got a time limit to be able to deal with the terrorists because if they're going to go past this deadline, they will have a lot of restrictions thrown in. You can think that will happen. But brothers and sisters, that is why on the northern side of Israel, towards the borders of Lebanon, even last night, soldiers are gathering. Brothers and sisters, equipments are gathering. And my brothers and sisters, they've ordered new, fresh equipments from the United States that is landing either today or this week. Now, some way, brothers and sisters, Israel realizes we need to round this up the best we can before we get back to the ICJ so that they don't lay any more restrictions. So, brothers and sisters, they said never again. And they will not allow, the terrorists to do what happened in October 7th again. So, brothers and sisters, we've seen, say on the 7th of October 2023, the day the most Jews have been killed since the Holocaust. This, brothers and sisters, have been placarded to the world. And the Jews realize that most of the people from the borders of Gaza, almost 80,000, 100,000 on the other side, where are they? They have left those homes. They are living in hotels. They cannot live forever in those hotels. So something has to be done. And my brothers and sisters, to bring security back to the nation of Israel. And the cry in every heart is to bring back the hostages. Brothers and sisters, that pain is tremendous. If you think about the Holocaust that happened between 1939 and 45, and to think for these number of years, they went reminding themselves, never again, and then to have this to happen. And brothers and sisters, the atrocities are too bad to even mention. Now, my brothers and sisters, with that, with a little introduction, we realize, brothers and sisters, 2,000 years ago, the Lord Jesus Christ, as he was going to go to the cross, he stood on the Mount of Olives and sat there, brothers and sisters. He gave the world a prophetic indicator. And my brothers and sisters, something that they could measure time with. And he gave the parable of the fig tree. Brothers and sisters, look at what the world has done with that parable. Look at how they've taken it lightly, brothers and sisters. But nonetheless, Jesus said, now learn a parable. And my brothers and sisters, we know that parable has been fulfilled because we see how Israel has become a nation. She put forth branches in 1948 and 67. And my brothers and sisters, she's getting ready to be able, my brothers and sisters, to build that temple. She needs that holy spot. And so we see that parable has to be, fulfilled in its climax. And Israel will have to have, the final ingathering of the Jewish nation. So therefore, brothers and sisters, we see in Jeremiah chapter 16 and verses 14, the world at large, brothers and sisters, has never wanted the Jews to come back to the homeland. The devil never wanted that to happen. Brothers and sisters, all of the Arab nations, it's not about, brothers and sisters, the PLO having a state of their own. It's that they don't want the Jewish people to have their own state. But brothers and sisters, remember, recorded in God's word is these scriptures. They lie there as a dormant seed, like a seed that is in a bottle. But when the time does come, brothers and sisters, God anoints that particular passage or that scripture, and he waters it. And my brothers and sisters, that process just engulfs itself and comes about. Nobody thought Israel would be a nation in 1948. That scripture was written in Isaiah 66. Behold, that a nation is born in a day. And my brothers and sisters, so I would say at the beginning of the 20th century, God was getting, brothers and sisters, this scripture in Jeremiah 16:14 to start to come alive. It says, therefore, behold, the days come. If you go on, you can read the chapter 16 of Jeremiah. Prior to that, it's talking about how the nation of Israel will be scattered at the four corners of the earth. And then she'll remain there for that period of time. But then into the end times, brothers and sisters, God will start drawing upon the Jewish nation to bring them back into the homeland. Therefore, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that it shall no more be said, the Lord liveth that brought up the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt. Brothers and sisters, this is an old traditional story. Yesterday I was moving the channels and it went on to the, you know, the Muslim channel. And you had this preacher preaching. And brothers and sisters, he was quoting scriptures out of Deuteronomy stating why Israel was chastised, sent to the four corners of the earth because they turned against God. And yes, they have to remain just that way. They shouldn't have been back in the homeland. And I thought, how come you're not quoting the other scriptures? Brothers and sisters, they don't look at this. God says, yes, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that it shall no more be said, the Lord liveth that brought the children of Israel out of Egypt. They know all about that history. They can talk about the Ten Commandments, the incidents of Moses. But God's word says, it shall no more be said. In other words, you will forget that outdated story. That is, it's a good story, but it's a tradition, like a broken record. You play it without any belief in it. So God says, the reason it won't be said anymore, because there's a better subject that is coming on the scene. So in other words, if you talk about that, you might as well think, God is going to have a better picture in our time. So brothers and sisters, we see that the Lord says it shall no more be said concerning that. But the Lord liveth. You see, brothers, sometimes we just read it through. We would have to think, why does the word of God say the Lord liveth? In other words, because at this time the world will say, where is your God? Your God is dead. God has left you. But the Bible says the Lord liveth, because they're going to see some things beginning to happen that brought up the children of Israel from the land of the north. Now, my brothers and sisters, this is a progressive scripture. We know for a long time. Brothers, Russia was paid to lock up the Jewish people. Don't send them back into the homeland. But when 1991 came, brothers and sisters, every obstruction, every barricade that the Russian government placed, brothers and sisters, the walls came down, the Berlin walls came down, because God was the one that knew it was time, because the scripture said, behold, the Lord liveth that brought up the children of Israel from the land of the north. Directly north is Russia, Soviet Union. From all the land, and it says, and from all the lands whither he had driven them, and I will bring them again into the land that I gave unto their fathers. So this is not all accomplished in one day. But if you turn back history to 1991, you will see how Russia was broken down. And how, brothers, the obstructions were taken away. Now, this adds up to that scripture where it says, brothers and sisters, I will, brothers and sisters, make a way, and he will clear the mountain. So, when he opened up the Berlin Wall, brothers and sisters, he opened up a small way in that sense, but in front of us is going to do it in a more outstanding way to all the nations that put a blockade to the final exodus of the nation of Israel. And I will bring them again into the land that I gave unto their fathers. Brothers and sisters, remember, this is a seed of scripture. And God waters that scripture. No matter how many times you can take Israel to the ICC or the ICJ, no matter how many nations will say what they want to say, they can only go as far as God sees what he will allow. And then he'll turn the picture around. Because we can see that happening right in our day, in our time. Brothers and sisters, so it says he's going to bring them back into the land that he gave their fathers. So it says, behold, I will send for many fishes. And that's going back, brothers and sisters, a few centuries back. We know at the beginning of the 20th century, there was a man by the name of Theodore Herzl. He's the father of Zionism. Brothers and sisters, he had a picture in his mind so that it would encourage the Jews to get back to the homeland. But you see, brothers and sisters, many of these Zionists, brothers and sisters, they were carnal as well in the sense they wanted a homeland because they wanted to be able to build a better future and brothers and sisters get rich overnight and have brothers and sisters all the good things in life. But also there were others that wanted to go back to the homeland to meet the Messiah, to build the temple. And brothers and sisters, God realized that my brothers and sisters, as those years came by, that God has to shake the thinking even of the Jews at that hour. And so, brothers, if there was no Holocaust, brothers and sisters, Zionism, with some of their leaders, would have went in a completely different direction. It would have to build an utopia for the Jews. And my brothers and sisters, all they would have thought about was, you know what, we don't really need the Messiah to come from heaven. We got the millennium down here. We got the kingdom down here. We've done it ourselves. And my brothers and sisters, so God had to shake their thinking. And my brothers and sisters, we see that God says, first, he will send many fishes. Well, these were the individuals that were very attractive in drawing the Jews, setting out a plan to start them to get back to the land. And no doubt, brothers, many of them went back to the land. And he says, said the Lord, and they shall fish them. And after, see the word after, after the fishes, after World War I, and brothers and sisters, at the beginning of World War II, after will I send for many hunters. There's a big difference between a fisherman and a hunter. Brothers and sisters, the way they conduct their business. Brothers and sisters, the hunters are there for the kill. Brothers and sisters, and that symbolizes how Hitler with his brutality. Brothers and sisters, you know the stories of the things that happened in the first Holocaust. And so we see, brothers and sisters, that God had already set the picture in the scriptures. And they shall hunt them from every mountain and from every hill out of the holes of the rocks. Brothers and sisters, the first Holocaust was becoming traditional. They went every year. They had a memorial. And they shed tears, but it was becoming traditional. Because remember, brothers and sisters, at the first coming of Christ, there was a temple to be built. And when they went there, brothers and sisters, there was such huge boulders and rubble. You read the scriptures. For 18 years, what did they do? They lost the vision and they started to build their beautiful homes. Brothers and sisters, this prophet had to come on the scene and say, since when? That, brothers and sisters, my house lies in waste. and your homes, the beautiful ivory and sealed ceilings and everything. And brothers and sisters, God had to send a prophet to reprimand them. And my brother said, that is why in the book of Zechariah it says, when they began to question, he said, it's not by might, it's not by power. It's my spirit that is going to move things to remove the obstructions. The same way here. Brothers, you would have thought that Jews would never get back to the homeland. But God had these things, I would say, to get them moving back into the homeland. So, brothers and sisters, after World War II, we see, brothers and sisters, there were, I would say, ragged Jews. Brothers and sisters, they didn't know where to go. They had no homeland. And my brothers and sisters, after 1942, brothers and sisters, in those years, the British, as well as the other nations, they put an embargo, they put a blockade. In other words, the Jews cannot go back to Israel, brothers and sisters. There were a bunch of Jews. Brothers and sisters, they put the money together. With $8,000, they bought this ship, which was, brothers and sisters, in a bad condition. It was a U.S. ship. They boarded the ship. And my brothers and sisters, they came to Haifa. Brothers and sisters, if you read about the story and the conditions, it was bad. Many of them were starving. There was no food. And as soon as they heard the ship had boarded and come to Haifa, brothers and sisters, they turned around and told all these Jews, they must turn around and go back from where they came. The Jews said, we refuse to go. We refuse to come out. And we'd rather die on the ship. Brothers and sisters, almost 5,000 on this tight ship. And so they came about with an excuse. They said, okay, disembark. And my brothers and sisters, we will see what we can do. But meanwhile, the people had a plan. The British and my brothers and sisters, the other nations. And when they disembarked, brothers and sisters, they began to, brothers and sisters, now get them all cornered. And brothers and sisters, slowly but surely, they pushed them back in other ships. And my brothers and sisters, they took them back, brothers and sisters, to Europe from where they came. Brothers and sisters, that was the starting, I would say, of these Jews wanting to come back. But they refused to go. And my brothers and sisters, you know, it didn't take a few months, brothers and sisters, that Israel decided, if nobody wants to declare, brothers and sisters, a homeland for themselves, brothers and sisters, on May 14th, they declared Israel to be a nation. That is why the scripture says, in a day, a nation was born. And so, brothers and sisters, we see the world always did not have a love. Why? Because, brothers and sisters, they were being palmed by the other nations surrounding Israel. And my brothers and sisters, till God had the time right for the nation of Israel to be born. Around the same time, 1948, God saw the Gentile people. He saw you and I. He saw our fathers. He saw our uncles. He saw us. Maybe some of us were not even born. But brothers and sisters, he didn't want us to be locked up in traditional camps, singing the same song over again. I don't mean nothing wrong in singing the same song, but singing it traditionally without the live wire of the Spirit of God, because that is what the Jews were doing. Brothers and sisters, singing the song of Moses, we came out of Egypt, but they didn't see the other scriptures. That God is going to change the song, or is going to change the agenda. And my brothers and sisters, around 1948, I would say, brothers and sisters, God began to start almost the same time as Israel became a nation. Brothers and sisters, God began to have a man. His ministry began to grow. And my brothers, Matthew chapter 13, 47. Because the Bible says, and the kingdom of heaven was likened unto a net that was cast into the sea. Brothers, it was to be a drawing power to bring in my brothers and sisters. I would say many of these individuals that had a desire to walk on for God, but there had to be an instrument that God would use. Brothers and sisters, that night in around 1950, I think, he stood on the platform when everybody was saying there's no thing as divine healing. And my brothers and sisters, the world thought, well, this was just an ordinary man. But brothers and sisters, the photographer that was taking the photographs, brothers, he began to take the photographs of what was going on in the debate. And when he cleared it, brothers and sisters, every other photograph became blank as such. This was the only photograph, brothers and sisters, that came out, and there was this halo of light over Brother Branham's head. And he didn't know what to make of it. My brothers and sisters, Brother Branham knew what it was. It was the same pillar of fire, but it was the angel demonstrating itself in that way. And my brothers and sisters, he was an agent, a man of reputation, brothers and sisters, and he gave his report. You may not be able to read that, but brothers and sisters, the gist of it is that he stated this was not touched. There was no Photoshop then. Brothers and sisters, he said the light hit the lens. And that's where that light came from. So brothers and sisters, they can do what they want to do. This man, he had a set ministry. And my brothers, it was a net ministry at the beginning. It was to cast a net for Gentiles. That is why we are here today. If not, we would be in denomination. Brothers and sisters, we'll be in other camps. But brothers and sisters, we know that it was in the beginning and the ending of all things. Malachi 4:5 said, he will turn the hearts of the children to the fathers. And my brothers, our hearts needed to be turned back to the apostolic teaching. But that's where you find that scripture, Matthew chapter 13, verses 47. So, brothers and sisters, as God was making a way for Gentiles, he was also to make a way for the Jewish nation. And my brothers and sisters, we fast forward from the beginning of the nation, brothers and sisters, to, I would say, 1989, when brothers and sisters, God was starting to rattle the United, the Soviet Union. And my brothers and sisters, God was going to turn the mountains into a way. So we see picking up there in Isaiah 49, he says that I will make all my mountains a way, and my highways shall be exalted. In other words, brothers and sisters, we can go back in history and state all the mountainous things that Israel went through. And how God has turned it around from 1948, 67, brothers, 83, up to, I would say, the recent wars. Brothers and sisters, but the word of God tells us that he will make all my mountains. Other translation says, every mountain shall be made into a way. In other words, no matter which mountainous obstruction or, brothers, political obstruction or opposition, no matter where it can come from, just look at it, brothers and sisters. Just a few weeks ago, all the nations were zeroing on Israel. Stop the war. You know, all of these things that are taking place. But brothers and sisters, God got the nations involved, Britain, brothers and sisters, Australia, the United States of America, brothers and sisters. Now they have to fight their own battle, brothers, with the Houthis. Compare the Houthis with the other terrorists, brothers and sisters. I have to say, that's not somebody you can sit on a table and you can discuss things with. Brothers and sisters, and then when they take them to the ICJ, and who takes them there? That's an arm of the United Nations. Then, my brothers and sisters, the reports come out that the arm of the United Nations, UNRWA, brothers and sisters, hits heads. That almost, brothers and sisters, I would say millions and close to billions of money is given to them to be able to help the refugees in Gaza, brothers, they were pocketing the money or doing other things with the money. And brothers, the United Nations and Britain and Germany, brothers and sisters, they have freezed the money that goes to that arm. And you know what money plays. Now, my brothers, when there's no money, brothers, the United Nations starts to fall flat. They will lose their voice, brothers and sisters, in accusing Israel, because Israel was telling them this all the time. Now you have to see that, brothers, all these mountainous obstructions and frustrations that they put against Israel, God ties them up in their own bag and he throws them into some water some way. God, he's that type of a God that can do that. And so, brothers and sisters, when he says, I will make all my mountains or every obstruction away, brothers, just in front of us is the clearance. Brothers and sisters, when that supernatural comes into effect, every mountain obstruction, opposition, brothers, the Bible tells us they will put their hands on their mouth. They will not stand before a mic to say, well, you know what, we got something to say. So we have to see the progression of this, because, brothers and sisters, it's God's word. So, and my highway shall be exalted. Brothers, he will remove the barriers. And you have to watch it daily in your news. Brothers, out of those barriers, sometimes they come, it is barriers. But brothers and sisters, God has a way to remove those barriers. In front of us, brothers and sisters, it's not going to be small obstructions taken away. Brothers, God's going to come with his bulldozer. And my brothers and sisters, you read it in the scriptures, in nations, kingdoms are going to be shaken. And my brothers and sisters, now would say, you know, when you're wrenching something and you can't open something, you get a big, we call it a babajan, maybe to open a nut. Brothers, God has a way to unloose things. And my brothers, the world has not seen what is just in front of us concerning the nation of Israel. I know it's very exhausting for the soldiers, brothers and sisters, the generals, even Netanyahu. Brothers and sisters, remember, it's freezing cold in the northern parts close to Lebanon. The soldiers, brothers and sisters, are almost in freezing temperatures. But they are fighting for those hostages. And my brothers and sisters, we have to see this is in front of us. The reason being, brothers, just as I would say the Berlin Wall came down, there used to be a final exodus of Jews to come back to the homeland. Remember, there's other scriptures that are there, brothers, that they will inhabit this place. And yes, it's going to happen through warfare, but that flag is going to shine high. I would say Israel's airlines, brothers and sisters, already Israel's airline to South Africa has been stopped. And my brothers and sisters, and I will say, because many things that are being done, my brothers and sisters, is to blockade some of the Jewish people. Now we see, brothers and sisters, as God says he'll make that highway and he will open up the way, then when that era of the miraculous takes place and the obstructions are cleared, we see the other scriptures start to get into effect. It says, behold, these shall come from far, and lo, these from the north and from the west, and these from the land of Shinem. Now, my brothers and sisters, remember, there are still Jews locked up in different places, or there are still some Jews that haven't made up their mind. But brothers, anti-Semitic propaganda in the world is going to force them, just like the Jews that were left in Europe. Brothers and sisters, when they didn't want them, and then the doorway was opened, brothers and sisters, and this attraction took place, they made their way to Israel. The Jews will want to leave a lot of these places to come back because of the attraction of the supernatural. So it says, and these from the land of Sinem. Now God had a reason to not put any other nation, but Sinem is places of China. Because it's an atheistic country, they wouldn't want the Jews to come from them. But some of those Jews or some of those individuals are going to see the miraculous and they're going to be attracted to come back. And my brothers and sisters, we see in the follow-up of that scripture, it says, sing, O heavens, and be joyful, O earth. Brothers, look at the world today. If I brought this scripture in after the World War II, brothers, it is too devastating to bring that scripture in there. After October 7th, you cannot bring that scripture in there. But if you say, sing, O heavens, and be joyful, O earth, and break forth into singing, O mountains, that's the nations. For the Lord hath comforted his people. Now there's going to be something so tremendous done that, brothers and sisters, every Jew is going to feel satisfied with what God has done. There's going to be a comfort come over that nation of Israel. Because remember, brothers and sisters, they've suffered major brutalities. Some of their atrocities, as I say, nothing in this world may be able to comfort them. But the Bible says, for the Lord hath comforted his people and will have mercy upon his afflicted. Brothers and sisters, the nation of Israel will be not looked upon as an afflicted people perpetually. No, God knows how to change the books. But brothers and sisters, as the scripture says that, we see that the land itself is speaking. Brothers and sisters, and you think, well, I don't say the land has a brain. But brothers and sisters, the Japanese and other people, they are proving, brothers, that our plants that we plant during the night, they communicate with each other, not with the mouth. They have shown it, brothers and sisters, they show the technology, just like brain waves, and they show how they communicate. Brothers, don't ask me how, I can't explain all of that, but this is the heathen world. And you know, it's been said in the past, brothers and sisters, people have played sweet music to plants, and they bore fruits in abundance. They played metal music and abusive music, the plants shriveled and died. They did the same thing to cows, brothers and sisters. So some way God has got his own, communication, brothers and sisters. But yeah, the land is speaking. But Zion said, the Lord hath forsaken me. So you have to see, brothers, at this moment of time, brothers and sisters, Mount Moriah, Zion, is sick and tired of an heathenistic, brothers and sisters, worship on the Temple Mount. It cannot accept that. It's waiting for the day of a lamb to be sacrificed on that mountain, which will symbolize and open the doorway, brothers and sisters, that the Messiah is going to come and sit in Jerusalem. Zion is not waiting, brothers and sisters, for another Jew or somebody. It's waiting for the Son of God who paid the supreme price on Calvary to come back on Mount Zion. So it says, but Zion said, the Lord had forsaken me, and my Lord had forgotten me. In other words, when it begins to recount, brothers, leaving the past, to the 1948, to the 67 war, there was hope the temple will be built. But now with all that is going on, only thing it's hearing is gunfire, warfare. Brothers, the land is beginning to speak. And my brothers and sisters, it says, but the Lord has forsaken me, the Lord has forgotten. My brothers, looking at the time, you cannot blame for the Jewish people to begin to even feel. But how come? We've gone through so much of things. But brothers and sisters, that's another scripture that says the same thing. But Zion said, Yahweh had forsaken me, and the Lord had forgotten me. It's the same scripture. But brothers and sisters, we have to recognize it's the same in our life. When we look at all that goes through in our life, there are times that you can feel the same way, that you're forsaken, you're forgotten by God, and that you know, Lord, if you were near me, why is this, why is that? Remember, brothers and sisters, God did not start our journey today. Brothers and sisters, the scriptures are written, Malachi 4:5, Matthew, Revelation 10:7. Brothers, God's not forgotten us, but some way God has been molding, separating, cleansing, shaking the body of Christ as well. So brothers and sisters, the scriptures, they speak for themselves, because the word of God says, can a woman or can a mother forget a suckling child that she should not have compassion on the son of her womb? Brothers, that's impossible. That's not natural. Brothers and sisters, that's the dearest thing in life. So God gives an equation to the land. He speaks back. And he says, can a mother ever forsake or not have compassion? It says it may be possible, but it says, yea, they may forget, yet will I not forget thee. Now, my brothers, sir, I hope with mega speakers that can be blasted in the ICJ, in the ICC, the United Nations, no matter, the whole world forgets about Israel. God will not. And my brothers, it may seemingly be, brothers and sisters, that's the way it's going. But brothers and sisters, we have to believe time is running out for the world, because this is God's word. And my brothers, he will water it and he'll bring it forth. It says, behold, I've graven thee upon the palms of my hands. Thy walls are continually, look at the word, continually before me. Brothers, no matter what anyone will have to say, that wall symbolizes the temple area, the temple grounds, as well as the city of Jerusalem. Why is the wall so important? Brothers, God is not interested in just the bricks and the mortar. Remember, this is the city of God. This is the city that redemption at its starting point. The Son of God shed his blood in Jerusalem. And my brothers and sisters, and in Jerusalem, the Son of God is going to rule and reign from. And therefore, you do not wipe that area out of the mind of God, because you'll be taken away from his plan. So brothers and sisters, God says, thy walls are continually before me. Brothers and sisters, that is to point symbolically to that city that is the eternal united city of Jerusalem. My brothers and sisters, we know that in a short while, brothers and sisters, remember, even in Zechariah's time, in Agar's time, how will this be done? How is it going to happen? Brothers and sisters, in that time he said, not by might, not by power, but by my spirit. In this time he said, I will make all my mountains away. Every obstruction will be taken away. And my brothers and sisters, imagine, we'll live to see the day a third temple come about in this area. It says, I've engraved you on the palm of my hands. Brothers and sisters, that is symbolic language. When you write something on your hands, normally, if you don't have a piece of paper, you write it, well, you don't need to forget what you want to buy. Naturally, but it goes further than that. When God engraves something, it's in the uppermost part of his mind. It's continually before there. And my brothers and sisters, it's in the palm of God's hands. He doesn't have a literal palm, but it's in the central part of his spirit. Brothers and sisters, when Israel became a nation, brothers, thousands of Jews came from other nations. All of those figures are there. I know you can't read it clearly. But a lot of people was brought back to Israel. My brothers and sisters, in front of us, we realize all of these obstructions, all of these mountains are going to be cleared. God's going to make a way, brothers and sisters, a free highway for the nation of Israel. Because the word of God says, thy children shall make haste. Why does the word of God say, thy children shall make haste? Because, brothers, from now to the point when I would say God's going to shake this world and the era of this miraculous, brothers, sir, there is going to be such a condition in this world that the Jews, brothers and sisters, will not say, well, maybe I'm going to wait for next year to think about I'm going to go to Israel. The Bible says they will make haste. In other words, the first flight they can take, they're going to go back to Israel. Thy destroyers. See, God is not a God that is not a caring God. He doesn't say, I will kill everybody, as the world wants to make it believe. It says, thy destroyers. That's every terrorist, every organization, every camp that wants to go against the agenda of God. God says, he will take them off the scene because he's going to move every mountain and he's going to make it into a way. Thy destroyers and they that made thee waste shall go forth of thee. That's God's word. Brothers and sisters, you and I think, well, when will that happen? Will it ever happen? Brothers and sisters, I just read this week, the Jews, they had a meeting, the council, brothers and sisters, of the settlers, so they call. They have already, brothers and sisters, drawn out the map of northern Gaza. They've named the streets. Brothers and sisters, they've already showed the roadways and the street names. After the people that have lost their lives in October 7th massacre. Brothers and sisters, and they're waiting, brothers and sisters, for the first go. Now, my brothers and sisters, none of the politicians have pushed them to do this. Brothers and sisters, and I don't know what the world is going to think about it. But again, I'm going to say, no matter what the world is going to think about it, the Bible has said a long time ago that, brothers and sisters, that the coastal areas of Gaza will be for the tribe of Judah. Brothers and sisters, almost 60% of the housings are already destroyed. But brothers and sisters, when the Jews came back in 1948, Haifa, Tel Aviv was a marshland. Mosquitoes bred. There was nothing. And my brothers and sisters, I have to say, when you read these articles, it's like a light blows up in your mind. Because, brothers, you think, well, how come these scriptures are falling in place like this? Brothers and sisters, I have to say, the world says they want to get rid of all this so-called radicals in Israel. Brothers and sisters, no, God is not in the business, I would say, of putting more destroyers in Israel. Brothers, they are a people of a loving nature that wants to see that, brothers and sisters, the Jews have a homeland. So it says they shall go forth of thee. Brothers and sisters, and I have to say, there is coming a final exodus. Brothers and sisters, no matter what the world is going to say. Brothers and sisters, we have lived to see how easy it is, brothers and sisters, to put blockade against the Jewish people. But after they did that, brothers and sisters, the judges, there was one lone judge from Uganda. Brothers and sisters, she stood against all of the judgments of Israel. May the Lord bless her for that. Brothers and sisters, but I will say, we're going to see more like that in the days in front of us. Because, brothers and sisters, he said, I will make all my mountains away. And my brothers and sisters, there's going to come a final ingathering. And I have to say, brothers and sisters, the Jews will come back. We probably, brothers and sisters, will just look at this from this perspective. Israel has, brothers and sisters, 30 days to be able, brothers and sisters, to be able to go back and say, well, these are the things that we've done. Israel has said, we have always conducted our warfare, brothers and sisters, according to the Geneva Convention. We don't have to go back and do anything. But brothers and sisters, they also realize their people are living in hotels. There's no security, brothers and sisters, on the borders. Hezbollah got 150,000 missiles against the people of the north. Brothers and sisters, what are they going to do? Are they going to let the people sit in these hotels or push them back? And my brothers and sisters, let missiles fire again. Only a foolish general will do that. Brothers and sisters, so no doubt between now and my brothers and sisters, the next round at this ICJ, brothers and sisters, I know that the president and prime minister of Israel will be thinking wisely how they need to go about this, brothers and sisters. But the word of God has already said, every mountain shall be made a way. Now, my brothers and sisters, we have many things more to say on this subject. I realize it's a very hot day. And my brothers and sisters, let us realize God has blessed his people, he's guided his people, and he will bless the nation of Israel. And my brothers and sisters, we thank God for his grace, his mercy in our lives, as he would lead us forward and onwards. We're going to have a word of prayer, and we're going to dedicate the baby. We thank God that we can come to this hour of time. Let's stand to our feet. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you, dear God, for your grace, your mercy, and your love in our lives. Lord, we see, dear God, how your word has said that you will turn, Lord, every mountain into a way, my God. Lord, you see your people. Lord, there is so many barricades in their lives. Lord, so many obstructions, my God. Lord, but your word has said, dear God, that you'll make every mountain plain, my God. I pray this day, my Father, that you'll, Lord, work a plan for every child. Lord, bless them, guide them, and strengthen them, my God. Minister to all your saints across the world. Bless your people this day, my Father. Lord, we commit this service now in your hands. We ask these mercies in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Amen. We're going to call our brother and sister to the front. I'll try. Okay. Okay, let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you, Lord, for this wonderful bundle of sweet joy, my God, that you've given our brother and sister, my God. I pray, Lord, that you'll bless the child and realize, Lord, that you are the God that watches over your children. Lord, I bring, dear God, Jodash, Lord, and Joan, Lord. I pray, dear Lord, and thank you, Father, for what you've done for them, Lord. This has not been an easy route, but Lord, your hands of mercy has been upon their life. Lord, I pray, dear God, and lift, Lord, Joel before thee, my God. Lord, I dedicate her to you, my God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Bless the child, my God. Bless holidays, my God. Lord, may the parents, Lord, Father, bring up the child, Lord, in the ways of the Lord. I cover, Lord, the baby under the blood of Jesus Christ. And I pray, Lord, you will add your blessings to it. We ask this now in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Amen. Bless you. Bless you. Amen. Let's sing a song to the Lord. Amen. Of my soul, my son, face a mighty mountain, can do the shepherd of my God. Amen. I'm going to ask my brother Basil to close for us in prayer. Amen.